Hello and welcome. My name is Chris from Swatera Media. Today we'll be looking at one potential way to rotoscope inside of the Fusion page of DaVinci Resolve. Even with the cool new depth map and Resolve 18 and some of the best efforts by the folks on the production side, sometimes rotoscoping is unavoidable. For the unfamiliar, on the most basic level, rotoscoping is the process of creating a mat to use in compositing. This could be rotoscoping a person to put them on a new background, cutting out the sky to replace it with a new, cooler one, or simply cleaning up the on-set mistakes of others who definitely meant well. If you're familiar with the process and just want to know this approach, here's the quick version. Get your footage. Analyze it visually to figure out the best point to draw the planar track mask. Pipe that footage into a planar tracker node. Select a decent-sized area. For best results, I found that only tracking translation is best. Create the planar transform node. Use the polygon mask to select an outline of the element you're rotoscoping, being sure to create separate masks as needed. Take the mask output and plug that into the input of the planar transform node. Take the output of the planar transform node and plug that into the mask input of the footage you're working with. Now, go through the footage, adjusting the mask as needed to fit the outline, making sure to leave gaps in time so you don't end up with a jittery roto. You know, just play around with it. Pat yourself on the back and take a few Tylenols. You're a roto artist now. If that's all you needed, great. Like and subscribe for more visual gauntlets like this. However, if you're newer to rotoscoping, stick around and we'll go over every step in depth. So as we briefly touched on, rotoscoping is a method used to manually separate parts of a video from others by creating an animated mat around your subject. Often you'll be able to use a green, blue, or fancy sand screen from Dune to remove your subject from the background. This makes removing the background a lot simpler. However, it's not always possible to use these approaches and you're left to do it manually. While this does sound daunting, modern VFX technology can help ease the burden a bit. Although you'll see me using the studio version of DaVinci Resolve in this video, I've confirmed that everything we're about to do can be done inside the free version. I promise you'll get the hang of this very quickly. Rotoscoping isn't that difficult, it's just tedious at times. As we go along, I'll also explain some of the basic principles of rotoscoping so you can feel confident in taking on much harder shots. I've left a link in the description to the footage we'll be using today. Now, some quick things that you'll want to do, even on my computer that's relatively fast, you might run into some performance issues while you're trying to use the masks inside of Fusion. So one thing you might want to do is, you know, create optimized media for your clip. And what you also may want to do is once we will go ahead and hop into Fusion, we'll want to right-click on the media in node and select cache to disk. So we'll go ahead and pre-render that. And this will just help with performance as we manipulate the mask that'll eventually be attached to a planar transform. Alrighty, so our first step, we want to just kind of analyze the footage. So in this case, like I had mentioned, this is pretty easy in terms of roto. We have a subject that kind of stays centered within the frame. It's also slow motion. And aside from, you know, the right side of his head here, it's pretty easy to see his outline. Now, in this case, we might not want to manipulate the footage at all because, like I said, it is pretty clear where the borders are. But if you did find that you needed to make adjustments to the footage in order to make it easier to see, the way you would do that, well, the way that I do that, is I just grab a color corrector node and then we'll grab our planar transform, or planar tracker rather. So now we have our planar tracker. We'll go ahead and plug that into the input and we'll make this the active clip. And what you could do is open up your color corrector. And in this case, in a lot of cases, I like to add some contrast. Kind of darken things, lighten things. Kind of see visually what needs to be tweaked But like I said, in this case, we'll just set this to pass through. I don't think it'll help us out much. And in the case of his face here, it might actually make it a little bit harder to see. So we'll start by doing the planar track. Now, in this case, you'll want to track the portion of the subject that you're going to start rotoscoping first. In this case, we'll start with the head because that's pretty straightforward. Now, what we'll want to do for the planar track, we'll find where his head is most visible. As you see in the beginning, he kind of has his head down. Want to do it probably here. We also see that he turns his head a little bit to the right. So we'll want to make sure that our track remains visible, because this is technically meant for tracking flat surfaces. But I find that the planar tracker is the easiest way to get the tracking set up. So what we'll do is I'm going to draw a small spline here on his head. We're going to set our reference time. And we'll also change our motion type to translation only, because we don't need this to track perspective at all. We just want the X and Y movements of his head. So we'll go ahead and track forward. And it looks like I was just on the edge of that thing flying right off of his head. All right. Then we'll go back to our reference frame by clicking go, and then we'll track backwards. All right, so what we'll do is I like to work off of a duplicated media in node that will eventually merge back over top of this main node tree here. So what we'll do is go back to our planar tracker. And since the planar tracker doesn't carry any actual usable information that we can plug into, we'll create a planar transform. And let's go to our reference frame. And this is where we'll draw our first mask. Now, in this case, I don't believe it matters too much where you begin. I'm pretty sure if we go towards the beginning and draw our mask, that's going to be totally fine. I kind of like that approach. I'd kind of like to start at the beginning. So we'll go ahead and do that. I don't think it'll affect it at all. Famous last words, I suppose. So what we'll do is start by drawing our first mask or roto shape around his head. Now I like to overlap. It's a good idea to overlap your roto shapes. So if I was drawing the shape for his torso, I would probably have it go up to his shirt. So I'm just going to include a little bit of this, the bridge of his shirt here, and we'll start making our selection. Now, this is not going to be the most beautiful roto shape in the world, but it'll give you a sense. Now, what's very important is that you not use more points than are necessary in order to get him traced, because as you'll see in a minute, if we have too many shapes, oops, that's annoying. Let's go back here. If you have, as you'll see in a minute, if you have too many shapes or too many points rather, you'll be in for a world of hurt, because you're going to be manipulating these points over time. Now, in this case, we do have these little flyaway hairs here. What we would probably want to do is do a separate roto for this really detailed work here up on his head. So for now, we're going to have kind of a more rough mat around the general shape of his head. Now, it gets a little tricky to see. You might need to zoom in and out and back again in order to see where things are, kind of adjust things around. I'm actually going to switch on high quality. So that, I think that's why it's dipping into, nope, okay. Trying to figure out why it's going to low quality like that. There we go. That's much easier. Now you might need to adjust those settings once we get to actually adjusting the roto shapes, because sometimes the mask doesn't always quite keep up with our playhead. Now if you have a graphic design background at all, this is actually a Bezier curve here that we're creating. There are plenty of videos that explain how those work. See how I'm grabbing these handles and it adjusts kind of how steep the curve is. It's probably not the right word for it, but you want to look up tutorials on Bezier curves if you're not familiar with this aspect, because knowing how to properly manipulate these curves will really help you out and make this a lot faster. Okay, so we have our basic shape here. We're at the first frame. So what we're going to do is go ahead and we're going to plug the output of that polygon node into the input of the planar transform. Now, one thing you might run into is since this is a mask, DaVinci Resolve might, by default, plug it into the effect mask, but that is not what we want. We want this mask's position to be affected by this planar transform, so we're going to put it in the input. Then we're going to put it in here into the mask input of that duplicated media in node. Now that was a mistake. What you would actually want to do is plug these things in first and then draw your mask. But in this case, we can fix this simply by moving that right over top. No problem. We all make mistakes, don't we? So now that mask should follow along with the subject's movement. And let's actually, we'll make this single viewer. Now it won't be perfect, and especially as he looks around, it will start to not follow quite as well. But what this does is makes it so that we don't have to move that shape every time we want to make an adjustment to it. We don't actually have to go in and grab it like it did before to move it into place. And anytime you can save on roto work, I mean, that's a godsend. Now, it's helpful to be able to see the rest of the picture while you're doing this. So what we'll do is we'll grab a merge node and we'll merge this media in right over top. We'll make that active. Now we can select this mask. So now that we have this moving and grooving the right way, what we'll do is start actually rotoscoping. And I'll kind of walk you through my process. Now there's a million different processes. People do this all sorts of different ways with all sorts of different tools. I'm typically somebody who uses Mocha Pro, which kind of streamlines a bunch of this stuff. But like I said, you know, not everybody has access to it. DaVinci Resolve is free, and this is a free way to do it, which I think is really fantastic, that everybody gets to suffer through rotoscoping and not just people who can afford fancy tools for it. It's very exciting stuff. So what we'll do is it might be tempting to, you know, go frame by frame and, you know, adjust, but what you want to do is leave plenty of space in between each adjustment. I don't really have a rule of thumb for how long to leave in between keyframes. It would depend on how fast the subject's moving. So if you have, like, say, a dancer, you might want to create keyframes that are a little bit closer together because those movements are going to be a little bit more extreme. But in a video like this where the subject is moving very slowly, you might be able to leave more space in between. So we're starting out on zero, of course, and in this case, you know, I would probably feel good about starting at frame 20. Now, it looks like some of these started to drift a little bit. We'll move this back. And we want to make sure that we have that it's on top of the subject. Now, this is going to be a little bit more loosey-goosey, but I'll at least give you a sense. So I'm coming around. Now, if the shape of your subject doesn't change a ton, what you can also do is grab multiple ones. Kind of do one of those numbers. Now, in that case, that didn't really help me out too much. So I'm just coming in and we're just making this, creating this mask here. Now, the reason for skipping keyframes, of course, is to, you know, not go absolutely crazy as well. So now we see as we move back, it's actually it's doing pretty well. Of course, you might run into some performance issues here and there. I'm not sure if it's like a bug that's been resolved, but as you can see, sometimes the mask drifts a little. I find that if I just moving back and forth or even just click once, that puts the mask back. And then of course we go 20 more frames. And I think I can grab these and we should be able to get pretty close here and pretty close over here. I also recommend some good music. If you are going to be doing rotoscoping regularly, I would invest in either a good pair of headphones or really bumping speakers, because it really helps to have some music going. It almost feels weird right now not having any music playing. But of course, I don't want to go to copyright jail. So now we have that. And as you can see, the magic is already happening. So what I'm going to do is we'll go to, let's say, frame 100. And then we'll start going back through and I'll show you the iterative steps that we take as we put that roto mask together. So this might end up being a time lapse. All right, so we've ended up with something quite beautiful. So if we go back, look at that. That's pretty nice as it is. It's honestly a lot nicer than I expected. You could actually probably get away with doing every 40 frames, probably. But what we would do from here, because you don't want to, you know, make yourself do more work than you need to. What we would do is start dividing these jumps in half and in half and in half and in half again. Okay. I don't know why it's doing that. We know our masks are good. So instead of jumping every 20 frames, we might do every 10 frames. And all you're doing then is, say, we'll jump to frame 10, make sure that's working. And these will be even smaller adjustments. So we might see little things like, you know, this gap here forming. We'll go ahead and correct that. We kind of look around, little tiny adjustments needed here. This is where the detail really happens. So we'll put that there, and now we'll go to frame 30, and we'll kind of keep doing the same thing. We're just coming in here and adjusting. Now this is a simpler shot. Other shots, I mean, especially as I mentioned, you know, perhaps someone dancing, flailing their arms, things like that might be a little trickier. But in that case, you just want to cut out a solid shape of them. If there's a lot of motion blur, you want to cut, you want to make the mask where there isn't, where the motion blur ends. So on their body, if say if his arm was flailing, you'd want to find where his arm actually is, because you can add motion blur to your rotoscoping after the fact. So then we come in here, frame 50, make slight adjustments. Now, like I said, this is not the cleanest roto in the world. Let's smooth that out. There we go. But that's okay. It doesn't need to be. And for a lot of subjects, you might be able to get away with not being super precise, especially if there's a lot of motion, a ton of motion. That can really hide a multitude of sins. But you always want to do your best. Try to be as accurate as possible. You really do need to balance accuracy with your sanity. It always pays to be a really good communicator. So if you're working with a client, you need to find out from them, you know, how accurate does it need to be? How much detail are we looking at here? And then you would need to charge accordingly, depending on how crazy it is. But if you're just doing it for yourself, that's a personal thing. Let's move 70. At this point, this doesn't seem super necessary. I mean, these points are pretty darn good. I don't know why a second point got created there. See, that's an example of too many points. I keep creating them. I apologize. I'm very used to Mocha's interface for this kind of stuff, but it is the same principle. No matter what tool you're using, there might be extra steps or considerations, but even if you're an After Effects user, this is largely the same process. Rotoscoping is rotoscoping is rotoscoping. And we'll just do 90 here real quick. Make sure that's looking good on that ear there. I use rotoscoping a lot in VFX shots, obviously. To comp together different elements. It can get pretty wild sometimes. Okay. I'm going to actually set this to 100. So our working area is just this. Now let's take a look at our mask. We should be so proud of ourselves. Look at that. Like I said, this part... always not sure. We'll add the motion blur to the mask. That should make it look a little fancier. That is looking so good. All right. And we have that merged over top of there. And, you know, for some reason we were wanting to do like a selective color. of just his head. I guess that's not the worst thing in the world. Yeah, let's do... yeah, doesn't that look wild? Yeah. I'd probably want to roto the basketball, but... as we can see, of course, we don't have the top of his head there, but that is something we would do separately. We would just... create our shapes around that. We would end up, you know, doing a lot more work on that. Rotoscoping can be avoided if you have good keys and things like that, but you know, it's not always the case. It's not always possible to have a good chroma key going on. There's lots of instances where you can also get away with pulling luma keys and things like that, but rotoscoping is always hanging out in the background there waiting for you. So you can do all sorts of cool stuff with it now. So that is just one approach to rotoscoping inside of Fusion, using the free version of DaVinci Resolve. The fact that we can do this for free and have it look so good is just amazing. So yeah, to review, all we're doing here is creating a planar tracker, tracking the thing that we want to roto, using that planar transform to move that polygon shape around so that way we don't have to move it around as much on our own. And then we're just doing some good old-fashioned roto work. Which ends up looking pretty good. Even you can see why I said, you know, sometimes you don't always need to be super accurate, depending on the shot, of course. Because from the normal viewing distance, you can't even tell that I did a crappy job with that roto. But anywho, I appreciate you watching our video here. We might be doing more videos like this. I like finding out different workflows and ways to accomplish things that you'd normally need, you know, paid software for. So I like finding out ways to pull things off VFX-wise inside of the free version of DaVinci Resolve. I love, you know, being able to save people a little bit of money here and there. So if there are any things that you would like to see, let me know. So until next time, stay healthy and safe, and take care.